Let's bow our heads, please. God, our Heavenly Father, Father, we humbly come before your throne now. And Father, we ask that your Holy Spirit will be present with us today, that we can feel his presence here with us today. Father, we're here out of our love for you, respect for you, Father. We're here to be ministered to have our faith strengthened, our hopes in you, Father, become even more alive than what they are today. Father, we are here because we look forward to the day where we will spend eternity with you, Father. Father, now I ask that the things I say today, Father, will glorify you. It will touch the hearts of all those here today that you led here today in a way that they need to be touched, Father. That will bring them closer to you, to help them see what life is truly all about, Father. So, Father, now I ask your Holy Spirit, work in our hearts, our minds, and our soul, open our ears to the message today, and I lift this prayer to you, and I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Hello, I'm doing great. Anytime I wake up in the morning, I know I'm doing great. good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Looking great. As you know, I hope you had a blessed week, right? You had a blessed week?
Oh, yes.
Amen? Okay, good. As you know, I always pray to God what he wants me to preach on. I don't have a list of sermons to give. I never know from one week, very seldom do I ever know from one week to the next what I'm going to preach. But I pray on every single week. God put on my heart what you want me to preach on. The past week or so, God put on my heart to have a message dealing with the challenges facing our young adults today, our youth, our young adults today. So I asked that they had remained in the service today to hear this message that God had put on my heart. For this Sunday only, we will have the scriptures put up there for you to read, because many young adults maybe didn't bring their Bible with them or are not prepared. So the scriptures for this Sunday only will be put up on here for them to read. But for now, if you will stand with me and turn to 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 16, the entire chapter, actually. 1 Timothy chapter 4. The Spirit clearly says that in latter times, some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons. Such teachings comes through hypocritical liars whose conscience have been seared as with a hot iron. They forbid people to marry and order them to abstain from certain foods, which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and who know the truth. For everything God created is good, and nothing is to be rejected if it is received with thanksgiving, because it is consecrated by the word of God and prayer. If you point these things out to the brothers and sisters, you will be a good minister of Christ Jesus, nourished on the truth of the faith and of the good teaching that you have followed. Have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tales. Rather, train yourselves to be holy. For physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. This is trustworthy. This is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. That is why we labor and strive, because we have put our hope in the living God, who is the Savior of all people, and especially of those who believe. Command and teach these things. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young. But set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preaching and to teaching. Do not neglect your gift, which was given you through the prophecy when the body of elders laid their hands on you. Be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them, so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Amen? Amen. You may be seated. Now this here, what we read, this is just part, and as you know, part of a letter that Paul had written to Timothy, young Timothy. I tell you a few things about Timothy. Timothy was raised, in those days, it was called the Way, in the Way. That's the same being raised as a Christian or being raised as a believer in God. So Timothy was raised in the Way, and he was raised by his mother Eunice and his grandmother Lois. They were Jewish converts, and they raised Timothy up from a child in the Way to believe in God, to believe in Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. The Bible doesn't say much about Timothy's father, other than he was a Greek, which is a Gentile. So we don't really know if his father had anything to do with the raising of Timothy at all. And this is probably why the scriptures say that Timothy was really raised by his mother and his grandmother. And also, it will explain why Paul considered Timothy as his son. Matter of fact, 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 2 tells you, Paul refers to Timothy as my son in the faith. So, looks like Timothy's father really had nothing to do with him growing up, okay? But mainly it was Paul and his mother and his grandmother. Now, Paul was writing this letter to Timothy to encourage him, to give encouragement, and also as a warning that we'll get into, and also giving Timothy insight into the nature of people. See, Timothy had kind of a sheltered life, being sheltered by his mother, being sheltered by his grandmother. So he was not really exposed that much to people and their sinful natures. So Paul is writing young Timothy here as a warning of what kind of people is out there, the type of people that he would come in contact with or interface with. As with Timothy, most young people, adults, you know, are eager to take on the challenges of the world. But like Timothy, they simply are lacking in the experience, which makes sense. They're still young. And so it makes it it's just not possible for young adults to really understand all the challenges that await them out in the world. Many young adults, see, either when they enter the world, that it's a wake-up call for them, because they find out it's not really what they thought it was going to be. So it's a kind of shocker to many of them. See, this will always be the case because young people were sheltered by their parents. Their parents provided their needs for them. Their parents sheltered them from the evils of the world, from the injustices, and from the realities of the world. So it's given that parents protect your children. So when they go out into the world as a young adult, it's a shock to many of them to see that things are simply not as what they thought they would be. So Paul here now is giving young Christian, young adults, and Timothy encouragement here and insight on some of the things that he will encounter as our young adults here will encounter when they go out into the world. Now the Bible makes mention of many young men, many young women, who from their childhood was faithful their entire life to the Lord, faithful their entire life to God. For example, Daniel. We know Daniel, he was just a teenager when he became captive from Jerusalem and taken to Babylon to serve as one of the wise men of King Nebuchadnezzar. But Daniel and his three buddies, friends, they were just simply teenagers. But they had made their mind up, no matter what, they were going to remain faithful to the God. They didn't even want to eat some of the foods that the king had on his table that were considered unclean. Okay. So God even blessed Daniel and his friends in that regard, allowing them to nourish and be strong simply by eating vegetables. So Daniel and his three friends, even though they're teenagers, remained faithful to the God. And we look at King Josiah. The Bible tells us that King Josiah, one of the youngest kings ever, he became king at 8 years old after his father died. And it says at 16 years old, he sought after the Lord, to seek the Lord, want to do what's right in the eyes of the Lord. He remained faithful his entire life, even though he was just a teenager, a king. And also we know that Mary, the mother of Jesus, married around 15 years old, just a teenager, she remained faithful her entire life. But you see these examples I gave you, what did they have in common? It was a choice that they made themselves. They made a choice to be faithful to God no matter what. Okay? Now, the Bible also mentions about those, matter of fact, who succumb to the evils of the world. And you wonder why. It has nothing to do about if they're being raised in the same family by the same parent. Nothing to do with if they're being raised the same. Let me give you some examples of that. You take Cain and Abel, okay? Here, Cain did not respect spiritual things. No respect for God. No respect for his parents. Killed his brother Abel. See, because he had pride in himself, okay? And so he didn't care about what his parents thought about killing their only other son. No respect for God by killing his brother Abel. See, no respect at all for spiritual things. No respect at all for God. But yet they were raised the same by Adam and Eve. They're raised by the same parents. One had respect for spiritual things. The other had absolutely no respect whatsoever. Another example is Jacob and Esau. Jacob had respect for spiritual things. Esau had no respect at all. No respect for the birthright, which part of God's provisions for the firstborn. Esau had absolutely no respect for it whatsoever. And another example, and I'm going to go back to Adam and Eve. They're both created by God. But now, the Bible tells you that Eve was deceived. And of course, she had to pay for her being deceived for the sin she committed. But if you look at 1 Timothy 2:14, it tells you, if you go back a page, it tells you that Adam was not deceived. Adam chose to sin against God. And it makes you wonder here, Adam and Eve, a personal relationship with God. He would come down and walk in the garden with them in the cool of the day, the Bible tells us in Genesis. But yet he chose to sin against God. Now what all these three, these six people or so that I mentioned had in common? What did Daniel, King Josiah, Mary, okay, Cain and Abel, Jacob and Esau, Adam and Eve, what did they all have in common? And they had this one thing in common, and that was to fulfill the desires of their heart. You will always fulfill the desires of your heart. See, now, the young adults today, there's so many challenges before you right now today. You have so many opportunities, so many options, so many possibilities in life to do whatever you want to do or to be whatever you want to be. It's almost overwhelming at the possibilities and options that young adults have today. You have to decide, do I go to college? If so, do I go 2 years to associate degree? Or should I go four for a bachelor's? Should I go 6 for a master's, 8 for a doctorate or PhD? Okay. Should I learn a skill? Should I learn a trade? Should I join the military for a while, then decide? Should I join the seminary to be a missionary or to be a pastor? See, all these decisions that young people have to deal with and have to decide, what are they going to do? But I will tell you this, pray to God to put on your heart what he wants you to do. See, it's very important to do that. And God will put the desire in your heart. And I say do this because, as I showed you, it is desire that's in your heart. That's what you're going to end up doing. 6 months from now, a year from now, 2 years from now, I guarantee you the desire that's on your heart right now, today, if it does not change, this is what you will end up doing. Okay? Paul tells us this in 2 Timothy 2:22. It says, flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Now let's look at this verse closely here. And this is Paul writing to Timothy again in the second letter to Timothy. It says, flee from evil desires of youth. Youth, you will have evil desires. Because you're sinful nature, you will have it. And Paul is saying to Timothy, flee from these evil desires. But instead he says, Timothy, but do this, pursue righteousness. Pursue faith, okay? Faith in God. Pursue love and peace. But he's telling Timothy, not by yourself, but he's saying, pursue this along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. So right now, he's defining to Timothy who his friends should be. He's saying, Timothy, pursue faith, love, righteousness, and peace. Pursue this along with those who also love God. Pursue it along with those who also have a pure heart. So he's telling Timothy, hang out with this type of people. Because the Bible tells you that, I wouldn't say evil people, but the Bible tells you that bad association will really draw you away from your faith. Guaranteed. Bad association will draw you away from the faith that you were raised in. It will draw you away from the Lord. And this is what Paul is telling Timothy. No, you pursue righteousness, love, peace, and so forth with those also who have a pure heart. A pure heart means those who really love the Lord. A pure heart is those who really want to do what's right. And this is what he's telling Timothy to do here. Once you leave the shelter, young adults, the shelter and love of your parents and just your protection from your parents, okay? Like I say, it's an eye-opener for you. And many of the young adults end up coming back home because they see the world. The challenges out there are difficult. It's not really what maybe they thought it was going to be. So many of them end up coming back home. But some young adults, okay, they become deceived. And they adopt the beliefs of the world, okay? They start accepting the world's custom, okay? Its morals. So a lot of young people fall into that category. I'm going to give you some statistics from a survey. But instead of using percentages, I'm going to use whole numbers, easier to relate to. But this survey says that out of 100 young people, once they go out on their own, out of 100 young people, 80 of them will end up walking away from their faith. That's 80 out of 100 will end up walking away from their faith because they will succumb to the desires of the world. And number two reason is because when they join college, their professors brainwash them and make them seem silly for believing in God. Amen. But as they get older, the survey shows, as they get older, 80 of these 100 who walk away from the Lord, okay, they get older and they get married and they have kids. 20 of those 80 come back to the Lord like the prodigal son. Which means then, out of 100 young adults who were believers in the Lord, only 40 remained faithful their entire life. Only 40 out of 100. You see, the world is trying to entice you, your heart, by all kind of desires. They look like they're fun, look like they're exciting, look like, you know, adventurous. See, but in reality, they're going to be short-lived. And one day, they will come to an end. See, the world would have you believe that the Bible is behind the time, that God didn't really know, or he was not aware that this would happen, or God was not aware that would happen. Some young people out in the world, or the world itself, try to tell you, oh, God didn't really understand that, how the morals of society were going to change. You say, oh, God didn't know that, okay? What kind of God would that be? God knows everything. The Bible says God knows the beginning from the end, which means he knows how things are going to start, and he knows how things are going to end. God knows absolutely everything there is to know. You will never hear God say, I didn't know that. That was a complete surprise to me. What am I supposed to do? Yeah. But some people believe that. They want to believe that. Oh, God could not look ahead and see how society was going to be, how the morals were going to digress, how they were going to change. But they tell themselves this just to justify what they are doing out in the world. What we read in Paul's letter to Timothy, it was what Timothy was going to really in face. So it was warning Timothy about the things that he would be faced with that was coming upon him. And he tells you that some of his friends would abandon the faith. See, now, if you look back at First Timothy, the very first verse we read in chapter 4, okay, if you turn there, it says, the Spirit clearly says that in latter times, some will abandon the faith and will follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons. So now, see, Paul is warning Timothy here that some of your own friends, see, they're going to abandon the faith. So he's letting Timothy know, don't be stumbled by this. If you see some of your friends abandon the faith, it says that they will follow deceiving spirits, okay? And things taught by demons. Now, what would be taught by demons? That's things that's against God. Things that are against the Bible. Things that are against Jesus Christ. They teach things like, oh, the Bible was written by man. You can't believe it. They teach that, oh, Jesus was just a master, just some man. He wasn't really God, second God of Trinity. They teach things about, oh, there's really no God. There's just this force in the universe. So Paul is warning Timothy, no, they're friends of yours. They will start believing these things taught by demons, and they will abandon the faith. Paul tells them that this will happen in latter times. Some interpretations say the end times. Say we are the last day. We are in the last day. The last day started at the ascension of Jesus Christ. We have been in the last days now for 2,000 years, and we see things are getting progressively worse than when in Timothy's time. We know that, yes, some believers will be deceived like Eve was deceived. And we can see by that survey, out of 100 young adults brought up in believing in God, only 40 out of 100 will remain believers in God. Those of us who are older, we can easily look back at the way things were when we were a youth. We can see now that there's no respect at all, hardly at all, for authorities. Practically no respect for teachers at all. No sanctity of life at all. A person now will shoot and kill you just as soon as look at you. They absolutely do not care. So we can look at when we were a youth, those who are up in age, and we can see how things have changed drastically, and they are only getting worse and worse. For you young adults now, ask your grandparents. Ask your great-grandparents, your great-great-grandparents, if they're alive. Ask them how things used to be when they were a youth. And they will point out to you, yes, things are getting worse each generation. From your great-grandmothers to your great-grandmother, or father, parents, grandmother, things are getting worse and worse and worse. But the question is why? Why are things progressively getting worse within society? You see, society is pulling further and further away from the teachings of the Bible. The more you get away from the teachings of the Bible, the worse you will become morally. And this is what is happening in society. So Paul is warning Timothy about this, warning young adults about this. Do not accept the beliefs of the world. Don't be involved into the teachings of the world. Don't accept the morals of the world. See, God is going to bring all this to an end. He has no choice. And that's why Jesus said in the Lord's prayer for his kingdom to come. Yeah? As young adults, you cannot relate to how things used to be. As young adults, you only know the now. That's all you know, okay? But look at the way things are now. Look at the drug scene now, the way it is now. Look at the crime and the violence, the way it is now. Look at the lawlessness, the way it is now. And you can tell, that's not normal. See, it's not society's place to decide what is normal. It's not society's place to decide what is right and wrong. See, only God can decide that. To you young married adults, and some of you may be considering getting married, look at the way society is now. Look at the way you would have to raise your kids in society outside these walls. And I know you don't want to do that. That's why Jesus said, pray for his kingdom to come. Yeah, it's all coming to an end. But when it comes to an end, well, God just turned his head to those who committed these most violent crimes, okay? The most disgusting crimes imaginable. Well, God just turned his head as though it never happened and never hold anyone accountable for these things. You see, that would not be love. Would you allow your kids to commit the most horrific crimes imaginable and just turn your head like nothing happened? You would not. You would discipline them. You would do something about it. And this is why God is going to do something about it. See, society is having you believe that you can do anything you want out there. Murders, mass shootings, whatever may happen. But society has you believing that you can do anything you want imaginable. And when you die, you'll go to heaven. There'll be one happy family. Those who did what's right, loved God, lived a Christian life. And those who were vile, worst crimes, heinous crimes imaginable, the world will have you believe it could be all one big happy family in heaven. No. It will never be, okay? There's only one way to heaven, and that's Jesus Christ. There's only one way to heaven, okay? And that to repent of your sin and ask for forgiveness and accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. That God being a just God, and he is a just God, he allows each person to reap what they've sown. That's justice. See, there's a good part of this. God says, you reap what you sow. God is saying, if you do good, goodness, if you help those in need, God is saying, if you do this, good things will happen to you. God is saying, if you do this, you will be blessed, reaping what you sow. That's his law. Okay? But also, that law means if you do vile things, if you do evil things, okay, things against God, it also means now you have to pay for those things. But that's what justice is all about. You know, surely a person doing evil and ill will all their life and never repenting, surely they don't expect to be blessed for it, okay? Hosea says this in Hosea 8:7. They sow the wind and reap the whirlwind. Hosea 8:7. But make a note of that. I gave it to the PowerPoint person late, but Hosea 8:7 says, sow the wind and reap the whirlwind. Okay. There again, meaning that you will reap what you sow. But look at the good side of it. If you do what's right, if you love God, if you keep his commandment, you will be blessed. Yeah. And that's why we're here today, because our love for God. We want to do what's right, and we will be blessed for it. When we obey men's laws, there's no reward expected other than the authorities leaving us alone. When we break men's laws, yes, there's a consequence to pay. Depending on the law that we broke, either slap on the wrist, maybe jail, maybe prison for life, or maybe the death penalty. See, but when we obey God's laws, which he expects us to do, if we obey his laws, he blesses us for it. And when we break his law, if we repent and ask for forgiveness, he forgives us for it. Totally different than men's law. See, God is patient with us because he wants us to repent. But many people take God's patience as the sin that they're involved with. Oh, it's okay, or God would have done something about it by now. But look what Peter says in 2 Peter 3:8. 2 Peter 3:8. Maybe it's okay. My eyes. I'm sorry, 3:9, all right. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repent. God is simply patient with you. He knows you're involved in this sin. Don't think because he didn't do anything about it. No, you will reap what you sow. Don't think because he didn't do anything about it, it's okay in his eyes. No, no, no. He is simply patient with you, giving you time to repent, because he does not want to see anyone destroyed. For your young parents, I want you to point out to you in this one scripture. And I know you read this scripture, you heard this scripture many, many times, but this one scripture will explain to you why 80 young adults out of 100 will walk away from the Lord. And 60% of them will never return. And that's in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 5 through 9. It says, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols like bracelets on your hands. And bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. I'm going to point to you why 60% of 60 young adults out of 100 never return home. I've never returned to the Lord. They will walk away. Look at verses 5 and 6. Love the Lord God with all your heart. See, it's the heart. Look at verse 6. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. This is what I said in the beginning. You will follow your heart's desire. Giving your kids knowledge does not equate to a love of God in their heart. Yes, we give them knowledge of God. But the key here is you don't want them to walk away, to be part of that 60% that end up walking away from the Lord and never return. It must be in their heart, because they will end up following their heart's desire. You young adults here today, you will end up guaranteed following your heart's desire. Okay? You take Abel, Daniel, and his three friends. You take Jacob and Mary, and many, many other young people in there who successfully resisted the temptations of the world. But they had that one thing in common. They had a love for God in their hearts. And that's why they did not walk away. I want to close with a reminder. We're all in a spiritual warfare. And you young adults, you must take this seriously. Satan is out to destroy your soul. He's out destroying you in any way he can, if possible. And this is no joke. This is seriousness. He's out to deceive you to go into the world, deceive you to walk away from your faith. And I want to warn you about this. You must take this spiritual warfare seriously. He will put people in your path to draw you away from the Lord, entice you with the desires of the world that look so tempting and exciting. But I want to tell you this. The greatest protection that we have, all of us, is our faith, is our shield of faith. Satan is out to destroy that shield of faith, the faith of yours. But that's our greatest protection, to shield of faith. But our greatest weapon is prayer. Do not ever underestimate the power of prayer. Okay? Satan cannot stop us from praying. Satan cannot stop God from hearing our prayers. But he will try to do all he can to keep us from hearing God's answer, as he did with Daniel. Okay. But our greatest weapon is that of prayer, the power of prayer. So for all you young adults, you must make a choice. See, the same choice that was put before Abel, King Josiah, Jacob, Daniel, Mary, and many others, the same choice was put before them. Will you be faithful, or will you walk away from the Lord? Okay? And I'm pretty sure you will make the same choice that they made, and that's to remain faithful to your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. Let's bow our heads. God, our Heavenly Father. Father, this message today that you put on my heart is for the young adults. That was on the heart of Paul writing to Timothy. It's not to be deceived. The world, things in the world are coming to an end, and then what? That they must make that choice to remain faithful to you to the very end, your entire life. To love you. To have that love in their heart for you, to do what's right. And that everything that they do, that it will glorify you, Father. Help the young adults now, Father. Have this love in their heart. And that the Holy Spirit now will work in them in a mighty way on that narrow path. That they won't sway to the left, they won't sway to the right. But they will keep their eyes focused on you. And if they need to repent, Father, put on their hearts to repent. Ask for forgiveness, and you will forgive them. And so, Brother Christ, now will wash them their robe clean once again. And today can be the first day of the rest of their life that they can lift their head up high because of the love that they had for you. So, Father, guide them, protect them. And the challenges of the world today, help them to persevere in prayer, a powerful weapon, and to keep faith, to keep the faith, the shield of faith in you. So Father, now I lift this prayer up to you, Father, and all those here today. I know it's not a coincidence that there's parts of this message that will apply to their heart, that it will reach their heart. That when they leave here today, Father, they will feel closer to you, more in love with you, more determined to do your will and not their will, Father. That they will put your will first in their life and not their own fleshly desires and things that they want to do. So help them, Father, in that respect. So I lift this prayer for you, Father, knowing that you will answer this prayer in your own way and your own time. And I ask these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.